after Easter, Good Shepherd Sunday. And actually for this week, it'll be just a little different. We're leaving the narrative lectionary where we just work through the Bible, beginning in Genesis in the fall and working our way through to the New Testament. And then we've been in Acts recently, the story of the church, the body of the risen Lord. But we're taking a break and we're going to the old familiar lectionary that we know, Good Shepherd Sunday. And the reason we're doing that is because our guest preacher is Bishop Michael Burk. This week was supposed to be when our Synod Assembly was scheduled, but because of these COVID-19 protocols, we're not having that. But one of the things that he had planned to do this year for the Synod Assembly, because it would be during Sunday, was he was going to provide a sermon. And so he still wanted to do that. And so we'll cut in to that sermon when it gets to that point. And actually, it includes the gospel reading. And so that'll be nice. I suspect churches all across our synod will be hearing this same sermon, and that's a nice point of connection. I've heard the sermon. It's a very nice sermon. And there was some other thing I wanted to say about it, but I'm not remembering what that is now. So just a few other things before we get started. Our lector will be Tanya Dunlap, and we'll cut in for that as well. And if you would like to do that, get a hold of us and let us know that. I'd be happy to help with some part of the service. And you could either just record that at home and send the video to us, or if you have trouble figuring that out, we've arranged other ways to help make that happen. So we don't want to spend too much time with announcements, so just a few other things. Pentecost Sunday, which is the last Sunday in May and Saturday. The story of Pentecost, as you all know, is the story of the Holy Spirit giving all of Jesus' followers, filling them with the Spirit so full that they end up, all of them themselves, speaking about God's mighty deeds. And we thought we could do that. And in fact, these strange circumstances, in a way, make it a little easier. So what we're inviting you to do is to choose a Bible verse or a hymn that means something to you, and then just record a simple little video about why it means something to you, and then to get those to us. And then for our Pentecost worship, we'll include those, and so it'll be sort of like a little Pentecost happening among us. And if that sounds like fun for you, but the idea of how to do it is a little daunting, each week I'll have a little video about how to go about writing something like that, and they'll be really short, and it'll just kind of help you kind of get your hooks into it and get started. So if that's interesting to you, keep an eye out on our Facebook pages for that video of how to do that. And the deadline we're looking for isn't until the 27th of this month, so there's plenty of time. The last two that I have is, of course, we're not having communion right now, and that's been something that nourishes our faith, and of course we all miss, and we've been talking about it. And this, our Lutheran heritage has a lot to say about communion. In fact, it's quite a unique way, a unique take on it. And so we're getting a little reading group. We won't be meeting in person. We'll be using technology to do this. And we're going to read a very important work of Martin Luther's called The Babylonian Captivity of the Church. In 1521, he wrote three very important documents. These are so important. And we're going to read one of them. It's The Babylonian Captivity of the Church. And it talks about, it's basically what makes a sacrament. And so that's what we'll be discussing. And that'll be interesting for us thinking about communion. And not only will we be doing that and studying something that's timely, you'll be reading Luther's own words. And that's so important for us. And you'll be reading, frankly, a very important historical document. So that'll be going on. And if that's interesting to you, reach out to us. However you got this video, just comment and say, hey, I want to be a part of that. And we'll get you everything you need. And then the last thing is, if just through the internet you've happened to come across these, and that's how you've been going to church, and you don't have a church home, well, now you do. You're a part of our family, and so we hope that you'll reach out, because it's harder on our side to see you. So just send us a message saying, hey, I found this, I'd like to know more, and we'd be happy to be in touch. For now, it'll probably be through sending messages, but we hope you will do that. So that's more than enough announcements. Let's begin our worship. And we begin right here on page one of your bulletin. That was the last thing I forgot to say. If you're having trouble getting the digital version of your bulletin, so when Amanda and I watch, we have a computer and a phone that can do these things. And so on the computer, we pull up the video. On the phone, we look at the bulletin and we just go through it that way. And that's how you have the digital one. But if that's a little tricky for you, get a hold of us and we can get you a paper copy that'll work all the time. You'll just, when it gets to the Bible verses, we'll have to turn there. But someone pointed that out, that that'd be helpful. And that's really easy to do. So we'd be happy to do that. All right, well, now let's begin our worship. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Our call to worship is Luther's morning prayer. Let us pray.
I give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have protected me through the night from all harm and danger. I ask that you would also protect me today from sin and all evil, so that all my life and actions may please you. Into your hands I commend myself, my body, my soul, and all that is mine. Let your holy angel be with me, so that the wicked foe may have no power over me. Amen.
We are so bold to pray to God like this because in Jesus Christ, God removes all that would separate us from God. Let us each receive this wiping away, this being made new, this forgiveness that God offers us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God,
We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. Through the Holy Spirit, God gives us faith to set our hearts on these words. Believe in the good news. Amen.
Amen.
Our gathering hymn is Guide Me, Ever Great Redeemer. You can find that in your worship booklet, hymn number 618, Guide Me, Ever Great Redeemer. Let us sing together.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
For our prayer of the day, a little typo made it in the bulletin, and it's not all bold, but let's do pray the prayer of the day together, even though it's not all bolded. Let us pray together. Let us pray.
O God, our shepherd, you know your sheep by name, and lead us to safety through the valleys of death. Guide us by your voice, that we may walk in certainty and security to the joyous feast prepared in your house, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
And now Tanya Dunlap will be our lector.
Our first reading is from Acts, chapter 2, beginning with the 42nd verse. The baptized devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all, as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm for tonight is Psalm 23. We will read it responsively. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters.
You restore my soul, O Lord, and guide me along right pathways for your name's sake.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup is running over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Our second reading is from 1 Peter, chapter 2, beginning with the 19th verse. It is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure what you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten. But he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in the body on the cross, so that free from sin, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you are going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. Here ends the second reading.
Thanks be to God. Now, to prepare ourselves for the gospel reading, we sing the gospel acclamation. Bishop Michael Burk, and the sermon will also be delivered by him.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the 10th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Dear friends, grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. This was supposed to be the day when many of us were still together at a synod assembly, the day of celebrating the election of a brand new bishop, the day of returning home with a poster to display in your own congregation, reflecting a theme to shape the coming year, with a new song, acknowledging that new leadership, new challenges, new possibilities warrant new ways of praising God, singing of hope and joy with a new song. This was supposed to be that day. Instead, there is this virus that has done away with so many supposed-to-bes. Who could have imagined how quickly, how completely some fundamental things would change? It feels like almost everything has changed. Even going for a walk is different. I've seen more of my neighbors in the last 12 days than I've seen them in the last 12 years. When the weather is nice enough, it appears that everybody's out, which means that you have to be more alert, more attentive in order to maintain social distancing when meeting someone, often competing for the same walkway or the same side of the street. From our front door, I can walk less than 10 minutes and be on an edge of town where the countryside is visible just beyond a barnyard that is frequently occupied by a little flock of sheep. It is a relatively tight-knit bunch, some grazing, others just gazing, a few mothers nursing their young, in other words, going about their daily lives the way, if I were a sheep, I would assume it's how it's supposed to be. I see those sheep doing what sheep do, and especially this week, it's tempting to conclude that they are a metaphor for our lives, a symbol of how this day for us, this time for us, was supposed to be gathered, that is, in a relatively tight-knit bunch. Tempting, because Jesus talks about sheep and his relationship with them, calls himself the Good Shepherd. But not yet, not first. First, he says, "I am the gate," mentions ominous threats to the well-being of the sheep, calls them thieves and bandits, making it sound like he's referring exclusively to people rather than to some infectious force that comes at you from outside. Sounds more like people who mean to do harm to others, and not just to any others, but harm to the sheep, to the followers, to the ones with whom we tend to identify as this story unfolds. False prophets, I suppose, or cheats, dishonest influencers, anyone really who you may meet who seeks to compete for your allegiance, or at least for the sort of relationship that Jesus claims for himself. Think back to what's just happened, or at least let me remind you that just before this moment in John's telling of the story, before any talk of sheep or shepherds or bandits or thieves, Jesus heals a person who was born blind, physically heals in the presence of all kinds of witnesses, from the local town folks to religious leaders, all of whom likely have some relationship with the blind beggar from the side of the road, even if only to look down on him, or worse, to ignore him completely. It is to these same witnesses and to that very circumstance that Jesus speaks, insisting that like sheep protected from outside threats, protected by an unyielding gate, this now seeing beggar is claimed by the one who heals him, has been gathered up into the fold, included, protected, saved, really. Not because of anything he himself has done, but saved by Jesus, caught in the grip of an unending love that will never let him go. I am the gate, Jesus says. Soon enough, he will say to the very same witnesses, I am the good shepherd. The way he says, I am the vine, I am the light of the world, I am the resurrection and the life. In every instance, really, Jesus identifies himself with the life, says it to anyone and everyone who ever needed any kind of healing or protection, assurance or help in the face of threats that can come at you from outside or well up from within. Says it to the beggar on the side of the road and to all the people gathered there listening, and says it to each of us in a still unfolding story that has already included water into wine, thousands of hungry people being fed, and sight to those who never even realized that they couldn't see. Signs, every one of them, signs that there are no limits to the grace and mercy Jesus embodies. No limits on the life he is determined to give. And just when you're tempted to think that there are, look around. Look around. You catch a glimpse here and there of some reason to hope. You experience some unexpected kindness. And you stumble into remembering that with this Jesus, there is always more. So much more life than we dared to dream. Even and especially when things are not how they're supposed to be. One of the most recent outbreaks of the COVID-19 virus has occurred in a care facility located on the edge of my hometown, where the countryside is visible just beyond. The circumstances there are not unique. Every day, brave staff members walk into a locked down facility to continue to meet the basic needs of residents who are more isolated than before, and now at even higher risk. For me, it's a reminder of how quickly this all gets to be so personal. So many family members, like my own grandmother, have spent their last days in that place. I remember more than 30 years ago, when things seemed so normal, Diane and I were in town with our then two little kids, and we stopped to visit my grandma. On our way out of the facility, we noticed a familiar name on one resident's open door that might as well have said Michael Burk's first Sunday school teacher. When I looked in, there she sat, much older, more frail than I hoped she would be. Her vision had faded so that when we walked in, she could see that we had little children, but she couldn't really make out their faces. I was pleased that she remembered me. I was astonished how quickly my presence seemed an afterthought. As she leaned toward my children and with a smile every bit as big as I recalled, she asked them, "Do you know this song?" And she began to sing, "Into my heart. Into my heart, come into my heart, Lord Jesus." And suddenly, no matter how she had first appeared, everything about her had changed. Now everything she represented was more than I remembered. "Come in today," she'd sing with a certain urgency. "Come in to stay," she'd sing to my children. She'd sing trusting, knowing what God is still doing, that God is still loving, still reaching, still healing, still holding, in Christ Jesus, still coming. Coming into every situation, bringing more life than we dared to dream. She'd sing that old song, and everything about that visit was more than it was supposed to be. I assume I am like you, in that I absolutely hate what this world is going through right now. My patience wears thin, my anxiety ebbs and flows on occasion. I'm downright afraid. This was supposed to be the day when we were gathered in various places, offering prayers of thanksgiving for a newly elected bishop embarking on a new era in the southeastern Iowa Synod with a new song. Instead, it is a day of remembering that with an old song, an old woman once convinced me yet again that with Jesus Christ, everything has changed. Because there is no force that comes at us from outside. There are no persons who might hurt us with or without intent. And there is nothing we can do to ourselves that can keep this Jesus from coming and claiming us as his own. Keep Jesus from being the gate that guards our going in and going out, the vine that maintains our connection even when we are apart, the light that breaks the darkness of our confusion and doubt, the healer, the savior who persistently comes into our hearts, comes into our homes, comes to wherever you are at this very moment, comes to be with you. The risen Christ of Easter comes to be with you. Praise God with a new song, or an old song, or any song at all, because today, right now, in the midst of pandemic, Christ is with you. Christ is with you, which, as it turns out, with you is exactly how it's supposed to be. Amen.
In response to this good news, let us sing. Our hymn of the day is Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us, hymn 789. The hymn's right there in your worship booklet. Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us. Let us sing together.
Thank you.
The response to the word is a response of faith. With the whole church, let us confess the Christian faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
On account of Christ's mercy, let us bring our prayers for the church, the world, and all in need before the Lord. Blessed Jesus, you have love us still, even in these circumstances when we long to gather before you. Even in these circumstances when it isn't exactly clear when and where it is right and safe and helpful and responsible to gather. And as we try to balance all those things that are impossible to balance, love us and love us still. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Blessed Jesus, you have loved us, love us still. Even in these moments when we feel so helpless and weak, when what we have to offer seems so insignificant. But bless even our smallest deeds with your great love. Let them be harbingers, signs, a breaking in of the power of your cross into our midst, a breaking in of your great love into this present world. Lord, we ask that you help us to do this in our own lives, with our own friends and family. We ask you to help us do this together as your body, even though we are spread apart right now. Guide us in our mission. We give thanks for our council members. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Blessed Jesus, you have loved us. Love us still. Love us still, even though we can't physically gather. Love us still with the power of your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, that does what we cannot, that unites us, that is bigger and stronger and more real even than the division of time and space, and even death. That when you unite us and we pray these prayers together, we don't just pray them alone, we pray them with each other, and we don't just pray them with each other, we pray them even with those who have gone to be with you. And we don't just pray them with each other, we pray them with your people throughout the world. And so we give thanks for our Bishop Michael, our presiding Bishop Elizabeth, for the churches in our Synod and the whole ELCA and the Lutheran World Federation even. And we give thanks for those whom you have called and aren't in our little Lutheran circle, for all Christians in the world, and especially Oak Street Baptist. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Blessed Jesus, you have loved us, love us still. And now we take a moment for everyone to bring our own prayers before you now in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Blessed Jesus, you have loved us, love us still. And we pray for all those who are deemed essential workers, who out of love serve us, who out of love take on risks that don't seem to be fair, who out of love leave their homes while we can stay in ours. Love them still. We pray for those who've been affected by COVID-19, those who've lost loved ones, those who are in the hospital, and even those who have died. On the cross, you show us that there's nothing that can separate us from your love. St. Paul listed a whole litany of things, and to that we can add, even COVID-19 cannot separate us from your love. Love us still. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Blessed Jesus, you have love us still, and those who know just how powerful that still is of your love, that loves us while we were still sinners, that loved us when we were dead in our trespasses, that loves us even when we are dead, when our heart no longer beats and our lung no longer draws breath, and your love still goes on loving, and your love creates new life every time, right now as we hear these words, and on our last day, when we hear your first word to us, saying our name and we rise up to new life with you. And those who have died know just how true this still is. And having all that, they sing your praises forever. And so we ask you to unite our praise with theirs. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And so now we raise these prayers and all that go unspoken to you, O God, in the name of the one who is, who was, and who is to come, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And now we continue with the thanksgiving for the word. Let us pray. Praise and thanks to you, Holy God, for by your word you made all things. You spoke light into darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
By your word you called your people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts, freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God. Rekindle your gifts within us. Renew our faith. Increase our hope and deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory forever.
Amen.
And so now be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God.
And we go with a song. Our sending hymn is one that the bishop mentioned in his sermon, Earth and All Stars, hymn 731. You can find it in your worship booklet. Let us sing together, Earth and All Stars.
Thank you.
And again, as we close, a word of thanks to all you who, as you've kept your distance, have also found ways to keep connected. It's been such a witness. Thank you. And now, receive your blessing. The Lord bless and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen. Our charge to the people, our conclusion of worship is the Lord's Prayer. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.